Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy.
Church, let's sing it again.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below.
Amen.
Praise Him above the heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Lord.
Come on, church, are you ready to praise Him today? Come on, hey. Come on, put your hands like this. Come on, hey.
I want to give you what you deserve and hold nothing in reserve.
No matter
how I'm feeling, I still believe it's what you deserve.
All my praise belongs to you.
Belongs to you.
All my praise belongs to you.
My praise,
amen,
belongs to you.
Come on, church, are you ready? Let's shout it out.
Shout it to the world, you're the greatest.
Sing it till it's heard,
you're the greatest.
It's what you deserve,
you're the greatest. Jesus, I will lift your name.
Jesus, come on.
Wanna give you what you deserve and hold nothing in reserve.
No matter what,
no matter how I'm feeling, I still believe it's what you deserve.
Come on, all my praise
belongs to you.
All my praise belongs to you.
All my praise,
amen,
belongs to you.
Come on, church, are you ready?
Shout it to the world, you're the greatest.
Sing it till it's heard,
you're the greatest.
It's what you deserve,
you're the greatest. Jesus, I will lift your name. I'm high,
oh, that I sing. Oh, we bless your name.
I lift your name, I'm high.
Oh, come on, church, are you ready to lift your praise on into this place?
Everything that has grabbed, praise the Lord. He is worthy to be praised. Everybody shout unto the Lord.
Come on, church, you shout. Ooh, amen.
We lift you higher, singing wonderful. For you are worthy to be praised. Everybody shout unto the Lord. You're the greatest,
amen.
You're the greatest. You're the greatest. Jesus, I will lift your name. I'm high.
Oh, we bless your name. Oh, we magnify your name.
I lift your name. I'm high.
church, wherever you are, we're gonna praise His name forever. Amen. Oh, 1, 2, 3, come on.
Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. He is worthy to be praised. Everybody shout unto the Lord.
Come on, church, you shout.
Oh, we lift you higher, singing wonderful. Worthy to be great, and everybody shout unto the Lord.
Let's give a shout of praise.
Woo!
Yeah, Jesus. Oh, we praise your name. Oh, we magnify your name, Lord. Oh, Jesus.
You are here as we lifting up your name, lifting up your name. You are here. Giving you the praise, giving you the praise. The kingdom of God is released in this atmosphere.
We're freedom.
We're freedom and breakthrough and victory are right here.
Come on, where you are.
And where you are is where I wanna be, in your presence. There's no place that I would rather be. With you, Jesus, it's heaven on earth.
Come on.
You are here. As we all agree, your power is released. You are here.
Oh, as your spirit falls,
as your spirit falls, there are miracles. The kingdom of God is released in this atmosphere. Ready for whatever you wanna do. want you, Lord, like never before.
Yes, God, your presence.
Your presence is an open door. So come now, Lord, like never before.
Yes,
welcome to SIBKL Online Service. Thank you for joining us today. I'm Pastor Lindy, one of the pastors here in SIBKL, and a blessed Chinese New Year to you. Let us know, what is the highlight of your Chinese New Year by putting it into our chat? And if you're new here to our service, come and say hi to us in the chat as well, because we love visitors and we want to give a big shout out to you. For those that have been following us on our pulpit series, we have covered 9 overcoming topics. It's been an amazing series. And you know, even for me, I feel this is such a powerful series for such a time as this, because starting this year, we went into MCO, COVID cases is higher than ever before. And for such a time as this, we can overcome. We have a mighty God that will enable us to overcome. And so this week, we will be starting a new series, the overview on the book of Revelation. I am so excited and I can't wait to hear from our speaker today. We will be going into a time of worship shortly. I really want to encourage you to prepare your hearts to connect with God. Invite God's presence into your space right now and let Him speak to you through this service. Let me pray even as we start. Thank you, Jesus, that you are Almighty God, that you are here, that you are present, and your love is for us. Fill us as we engage with this service today. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Amen. Before we go on, let's check out our SIBKL news.
Hi everyone, would you like to get to know SIBKL a little bit more? If you've ever had such questions like, how can I join a cell group? How can I serve in a ministry? How can I be discipled? How can I be a member? How can I join one of our SIBKL events? or any other questions, then I invite you to click on the link below and we will connect with each other via WhatsApp. One of our Connect leaders will reach out to you. We would love to connect with you, so we invite you to connect with us. God bless.
All you young adults out there, get excited. Our first YA Night Together for the year 2021 will be held this coming Wednesday on the 24th of February via Zoom. Spread the word and invite your friends to join us as we cast the vision for the year ahead. The Zoom link and all the details are on the screen now. See you there.
Hi, young adult family. I really want to encourage every single young adult to join us at our weekend watch and eat parties. We are watching our weekend services together and to connect with one another. Join us every weekend for our first service and our third service by clicking on our Zoom link on the screen. Follow us on our social media for more information and updates, and I really cannot wait to watch our weekend services with you. God bless.
One of the DNAs of SIBKL is to be a generous church. It is now so much easier for you to give. You can give via online banking transfer or Do It Now transfer. All you need to do is to scan this QR code and it will lead you to our giving page.
like? Do we know what heaven sounds like? It sounds like this.
This is what living looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise you. This is what living looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise.
Sing it again.
This is what living looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise you. This is what living looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise you. We'll see you break down every law. We'll watch the giants fall. We cannot survive when we praise you. The God of breakthroughs on our side. Forever lift him high. With all creation cry, God, we praise you. Oh, 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 we praise you.
Victor, and in you we are more than conquerors. The victory has already been won by you at the cross. And we give you all the praise.
You are always fighting for us, heaven's angels all around. My delight is found in knowing that you wear the victor's crown. You're my help and my defender. You're my Savior and my friend. By your grace I live and breathe to worship you. At the mention of your greatness, in your name I will bow down. In your presence fear is silent, for you wear the victor's crown. Let your glory fill this temple. Let your power overflow.
Jesus, you have overcome.
once your work was finished, you were buried in the ground. But the grave could not contain you, for you wear the victor's crown.
Jesus, yes, you have overcome. You have overcome. You know, we want to continue this time of worship with praying for the sick. And in this season of high COVID cases, we really want to pray for those that have COVID-19. End of last year, I had some of my leaders that was in close contact with someone that was tested positive for COVID-19. And they were so worried because they had a young baby in the house, and they quickly did a test and they were really wary about what is the result. Praise God, as they prayed and they came into that space to trust God, they were tested negative. And we want to believe today that we have a mighty God that can heal those that have COVID. On the screen, you will see Judy, Jonathan, Wong. Let's come and pray. Heavenly Father, Holy Spirit, we want to commit Judy into your mighty hands, even as she's in ICU right now with severe damage of the lungs, pneumonia, and pulmonary embolism. Lord, we want to believe you are a mighty God, and it's mighty to save, mighty to heal her. Power of God, invade that ICU right now, and we pray in Jesus' name, healing would come over Judy right now. Lord, for Jonathan, Wong, Lord, I pray that you would really even take hold of every one of them who have COVID-19 and just, Lord, break into their bodies, make them whole once again, heal them. And Lord, we want to believe for Judy, Jonathan, Wong, that none of them will have side effects even after they are healed. So Lord, we want to commit them into your mighty hands. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. For you, if there's any one of you that's unwell in your body right now, can I encourage you to just lift up your hand to God? And I want to just pray for you right now. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, I pray for every person in their own respective homes, their room, or wherever they are that has their hand lifted up. Lord, we believe you are a mighty God, and your power is going to fill them right now in Jesus' name. Your power will bring forth that healing. They will encounter you in such a deep way as your healing grace falls upon them. So in Jesus' name, we want to declare your finished work on the cross over their lives. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. 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 Let's move on to our sermon right now. Prepare your hearts to receive from God what He will speak through the speaker. Bless you.
Hi, church. Today, we are going to start on the book of Revelation, something which I've been waiting for and very excited to do with you, and I'm very sure many of you feel the same. Today, I'm just going to do an overview of the book, and I just wonder, how on earth am I going to do an overview of Revelation in just maybe about 30 to 35 minutes, but I'll try. And it's a very difficult book to understand, very difficult book to understand. And in fact, it has been said that there are actually two types of Christians as far as the book of Revelation is concerned. The first type of Christian or category of Christians are the ones who have an unwarranted fear of the book. Why? Because, you know, there's so many angels and beasts and dragons and antichrist, false prophets, 666 and earthquakes, and so many people die. Whoa. Another type of Christian in with reference to the book of Revelation are the people who do not have an unwarranted fear, but they have an excessive fascination. Angels, oh, dreams, they love it. And they interpret it in many, many diverse, I would say, kaleidoscopic ways. I am neither. I don't fear the book. And really, I was not fascinated by it. For a long time, I avoided it. Why? Because it's difficult to understand and it's not relevant. So last year, during MCO in March, I read through chunks of scripture and I came to Revelation. And as I began to read the book of Revelation, the Spirit of God spoke to me, "Son, I want you now to study the book of Revelation, verse by verse, phrase by phrase, nuance by nuance, vision by vision. And I want you to preach it and teach it because the time has come." Wow. And so in the last 9 months or so, I've dug deep into the book of Revelation, verse by verse. And I'm very, very eager to share with you what the Lord has revealed to me. D.L. Moody, the well-known evangelist, said this: "If God did not want us to understand the book of Revelation, surely He would not have given it all to us, right? So He must want us to understand." How will we teach this book? Let me explain to you that this weekend, on the 20th and 21st of February, we'll have an introduction. Next weekend, we will do the introduction to the seven churches. We zero in on the seven churches in chapter 2 and chapter 3 of Revelations. And then from March onwards until May, for 7 weekends, we will do Jesus' letters to the seven churches, one church per week. That will take us to the end of April, of course, with Easter in between. And then on the 8th of May, right until August, every Saturday, 10 a.m. to 12 noon, 2 hours, I will teach the book of Revelation. What's the difference between the May sessions and the pulpit teaching? The difference is this: you cannot preach on Revelations. It is not preachable. What is preachable are the seven letters to the seven churches. From Revelation chapter 4 to chapter 22, you can only expose it verse by verse. You do not do justice to chapter 4 to chapter 22 by preaching revelations. Why? Because when you preach, you tend to be exaltative. You want to exalt people. But how do you exalt people with a beast? How do you exalt people with one half of the world died by the time you reach the seventh seal? How do you teach? How do you exalt that? So it's superficial. So from May onwards, verse by verse, I will take you through Revelations every Saturday morning. We will open registration in March, and the first 1,000, we will cap it, and we will open it first to SIBKL folks. Just to let you know, I also wrote a book on Revelation. It's almost about 200 pages long, and it's not a commentary, but it is a supplement, because there are many things in the book of Revelation that I cannot teach, and we don't have time for it. So chapters on the book would include Jacob's trouble. What is Jacob's trouble? It would include the millennial rule. All right, I will explain deeply, and I will explain to you why I mid-trip, why I believe that the church and the Christians will go through the Great Tribulation, and there will be a chapter on suffering. But my best chapter in the book, and you don't want to miss it, is that God gave me a new understanding of death. And I titled that chapter, A Theology of Death. When you read that chapter, we will not be afraid to die. Well, that's the commercial. What I will do in the next half an hour or so is that I will go through Revelations chapter 1, because Revelations chapter 1 is a very good overview for the whole book. So let me read Revelations chapter 1, verses 1 to verse 8. And I would highly recommend that you have your Bible with you. If not, you won't benefit as much. So Revelation chapter 1, verse 1 to verse 8. The revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave him to show his servants what must soon take place. He made it known by sending his angel to his servant John, who testifies to everything he saw, that is, the word of God and the testimony of Jesus Christ. Blessed is the one who reads the words of this prophecy, and blessed are those who hear it and take it to heart what is written in it, because the time is near. That's why the Lord spoke to me last year in March. Son, teach the book of Revelation, because the time is near. John. To the seven churches in the province of Asia, grace and peace to you, this is a greeting, from him who is, and who was, and who is to come, and from the seven spirits before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness, the firstborn from the dead, and the ruler of the kings of the earth. To him who loves us and has freed us from our sins by his blood, and has made us to be a kingdom and priests to serve his God and Father, to him be glory and power forever and forever. Amen. Look, verse 7. He is coming with the clouds, and every eye will see him, even those who pierced him, and all the peoples of the earth will moan because of him. So shall it be. Amen. The word amen, amen, amen occurs numerous times in the book of Revelation. In other words, so be it. That's what it says. So be it. Amen. I am the Alpha and the Omega, says the Lord God, who is, who was, who is to come, the Almighty. Revelation comes from the Greek word apokalypsis, which means unveiling. This is where the word apocalypse comes. You know, many years ago, when I was younger, I remember watching a movie about the Vietnam War called Apocalypse Now. I can't remember much about the movie, except that there's a lot of bloodshed, napalm, and a lot of destruction. And I thought, maybe that's what apocalypse means, right? Destruction. No, it just means unveiling. In other words, as we read the book of Revelation, let us open up our spirit man and tune it to the same frequency of heaven so that we understand what God is trying to unveil to us. It's like a curtain, you know. It's like a curtain. When you push back the curtain, it is to let you see what is behind the curtain, right? So there's a whole purpose of God revealing to us events of the end times so that we can understand. Wow. I'm so excited, you know, because I know we are in for a wonderful, wonderful time. And I want to believe that at the end of this study, it's not only a theological Bible study, but it will transform your life. It transformed mine. I look at life different now, you know. I see death also different now. Yeah. Let me move on. Revelation chapter 1, verse 1 to verse 2. The revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave him to show his servants what must soon take place. He made it known by sending his angel to his servant John, who testifies to everything he saw, that is, the word of God and the testimony of Jesus Christ. One of the things that struck me as I read the revelation again and again, verse by verse, is verse 1. The revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave him to show who? Absolutely right. His servants. So to whom is the unveiling given? His servants. In other words, non-believers don't understand. And not every Christian will understand. Why? Because the revelation, the unveiling, the apocalypse is only given to show who? Servants. And you know the word servant and serve occurs 19 times in 22 chapters. Again and again. It is to his servants. In other words, only servants understand. Are you his servant? It reminds me of what happened at the first miracle at Cana of Galilee. When Jesus turned water into wine, it was his first creative miracle. And you know in John chapter 2, verse 9, who knew? The host didn't know. Definitely the guests didn't know. All they knew was the best wine. Huh? Revelation, John chapter 2, verse 9. Who knew? Only the servants know. Why? Because the servants were closest to Jesus. So the revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave him to show who? Servants. That's why you always hear me say, friends, don't waste your time chasing after shadows. Serve God. Incidentally, that is the title of my first chapter in my book. Revelation is for servants. The revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave him to show his servants, what must soon take place? God gave Jesus a revelation. And Jesus made it known by sending his angel to his servant John, who now testifies to everything he saw, that is the word of God and the testimony of Jesus. So if you look at the sequencing of the revelation, it is like this. God showed it to Jesus Christ, who now shows it not to John, angels. You find angels mentioned in almost every chapter. It is to the angel of the church of Sardis. It is to the angel of the church of Ephesus. Right. Angels. Angels are messengers. And the angels now communicated to John, who now communicated to who? Servants. So this is the sequencing of the revelation, and it is to servants. And do you know, go back to verse 1 and verse 2 again. He made it known by sending his angels to his servant John, who now testifies to everything he what? Saw. In other words, whatever is written now from verse chapter 1 to chapter 22 is a testimony of what John saw. It is a visual testimony. It's not narrated, understand? Jesus did not say, come on, John, sit down, let me tell you. No. John, let me show you. It's a visual testimony. And it's powerful. Again and again, you read, I, John, testify. I, John, tell you. Believe me. I saw and I now tell you. Take it seriously, my friend. Take it very seriously. Revelation chapter 1, verse 3. Blessed is the one who reads the words of this prophecy, and blessed are those who hear it, take it to heart what is written in it, because the time is near. I love this verse. Why? Because Revelations is the only book in the entire Bible that you are blessed when you read it. What? Yeah. Do you know that when you are blessed, when you read the book of Revelation, we will be blessed? And not only will we be blessed, are we blessed when we read the book? Blessed are those who also hear it. Hey, you are blessed when you hear it. And blessed are you when you, more importantly, take to heart what is written in it. In other words, don't hear only, heed, obey. Hey, so friends, my goodness me, we are blessed when we read it, we are blessed when you hear it, and we are blessed when we obey it. Hey, SIBKL, this year, 2021, we are triply blessed. Don't you want to be blessed? God promised you, I will bless you if you read this book, if you hear it, and if you take it to heart. You know, I found out, in fact, I wanted to give a prize to people, which I probably won't now, to anyone who can go through the book and tell me what are the Beatitudes of Revelation. What, Pastor? I thought Beatitudes only refers to the Sermon on the Mount. True. There were 8 Beatitudes, blessed, in Sermon on the Mount. Do you know there are also 7 or 8 blessings in the book of Revelation? I called it the Beatitudes of Revelation. Where, Pastor, where? Look it up, Look through and write down what are the 7 blessings. And God says, hey, if you read the book, all these blessings are yours. Amen. And 7 is a number of perfection. God wants to bless you. Not incompletely, but completely. Amen. Amen. I'm so excited, you know. We are in for a wonderful time, friend. Honestly, we will be blessed to our socks this year when we study the book of Revelation. Revelation chapter 1, verse 4 to verse 5. John, To the seven churches in the province of Asia, this is the greeting. Grace and peace to you from Him who is, who was, and who is to come, and from the seven spirits before His throne, and from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness, the firstborn from the dead, and the ruler of the kings of the earth. Wow. John, to the seven churches in the province of Asia. Next week, I will share a bit more on the introduction to the seven churches. You won't miss it. You won't want to miss it. But suffice it to say, and I want to debunk a myth right now at the beginning, to the seven churches in the province of Asia. In other words, right at the beginning of Revelation, John is saying, whatever I am writing, whatever God shows to Jesus, Jesus communicated to the angels to tell me, is to the seven churches. In other words, the whole book of Revelation is to the seven churches. What, Pastor? I thought only the seven letters. Did it say in Revelation chapter 1, verse 4, to the seven churches, I write all these letters only. Chapter 4 onwards, not to the seven churches, but to, don't know to who, No, don't know somebody else. No. Do you know that in those days, no chapter 1, no. No chapter 1, chapter 2, chapter 3, chapter 4, chapter 5, no, right? So in other words, when the Spirit of God prompted John to write this, everything from chapter 1 to chapter 22 is to all of us. Is to the seven churches, including the seven letters of Jesus. Why do I emphasize this? Because all the time we think that whatever John writes, Jesus writes, is only to the seven churches, and then chapter 4 onwards is not to the church, because the church already raptured, ma. Don't get me into this, because I will spend an entire morning, or 1 hour at least, or first hour of the 2 hours, telling you why I am mid-trib, meaning why I believe that the Church of Jesus Christ must go through the Great Tribulation. I do not subscribe to the pre-trib view, which says that the Church is already raptured before the Great Tribulation, and therefore the church will not go through the Great Tribulation. Sorry, I beg to differ. Just to give you a preview, one of the arguments the pre-trib have is this. From chapter 4 onwards, they say, the word church is never mentioned anymore. Why? Because it's already raptured. Therefore, everything from chapter 4 onwards don't apply to the churches. Church is already raptured because the word church is not mentioned anymore. Wrong. To the seven churches in the province of Asia, everything from chapter 1 to chapter 22 is to the churches. Why should Jesus write something to warn and to tell the church when the church is no more? Why? Why does Jesus want to tell the church to be faithful, to remain steadfast, persevere, when the church is no more? Doesn't make sense to me. And it's also not true that the word church is never mentioned again after chapter 4. Let me show you something, and I'll go on. Revelation 22, verse 16. That's how Jesus ends the unveiling, the apocalypse to the churches. That's what he said. Chapter 22, verse 16. I, Jesus, so that you and I make no mistake of who is speaking. I, Jesus, have sent my angel to give you this testimony. In other words, everything that I revealed to you in the 22 chapters, for who? For who? The churches! Listen, my friend. The church will go through the Great Tribulation. And we have to get ready and prepared for it. Okay, I don't want to go any further. Let me move on, because there are so many reasons I can give you why I am a mid-trib. And there's a lot for me. You know why? Because I'm brought up as a brethren, you see. And brethren are pre-tribs. John Nelson Darby, when he founded the Brethren movement in Glasgow, propounded this pre-trib that the church will be raptured before the Great Tribulation. And then he influenced a guy called Scofield in the US. And that's why I came to Scofield Bible. So when I was young in Bible class in the Brethren Church, I was taught, hey, the church will be raptured. But now, as I study the book, I beg to differ. The church will go through, sorry lah, the Great Tribulation. Revelation chapter 1, verse 4 to verse 5. To the seven churches in the province of Asia. Remember, I told you, no chapters. At that time, no chapters. One is a complete epistle. Grace and peace to you from him who is, who was, and who is to come. And from the seven spirits before his throne. And verse 5, from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness, the firstborn from the dead, and the ruler of the kings of the earth. To him who loves us and has freed us from our sins by his blood. This is the greeting. And I want to share a point here before I move on. How does God greet us? Like Paul, peace be to you. So to the seven churches in the province of Asia, grace and peace to you. And this is directly from God. From whom? From him. Who is him? This is God. Why? Because he is who was and is to come. And he identifies himself in verse 8. He says, I am the Alpha and the Omega, says the Lord God, who is, who was, and who is to come, says the Lord Almighty. So who is this? Is God, Lord God. And from the seven spirits. Who are the seven spirits? You look at the marginal notes. It is the sevenfold spirit of God. And from Jesus Christ now, who is a faithful witness, the firstborn from the dead, the ruler of the kings of the earth. So in other words, the greeting is from the Godhead. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. It is a Trinitarian greeting. That's how serious God takes the book of Revelation. Peace be to you. From God the Father, God the Son, and the sevenfold Spirit of God. Verse 5 to verse 8. And from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn from the dead, the ruler of the kings of the earth, to him who loves us and has freed us from our sins by his blood, to him who loves us and freed us and made us to be a kingdom and priests, to serve his God. Again, see, serve. I tell you, the word serve comes again and again and again. And the Spirit of God told me, son, tell the church, it is to the servants that I'm going to reveal myself. Please serve God, serve God. Why? Because when it comes to the Bema throne in Revelation chapter 19, when we come to the rewards, it matters. Two kinds of books are opened, the book of life and the other books. Your service to God in this life matters. Don't waste your time chasing out the shadows. To him be glory and power forever and ever. Amen. Verse 7, look, he is coming with the clouds, and every eye will see him, even those who pierced him. Can you imagine? In the book of Revelation, it's the again in mentions to Jesus who died on the cross. And everyone who pierced him, referring to the Jews, and the other peoples of the earth, the non-Jews, the Gentiles, will moan because of him. So be it. I am the Alpha and the Omega, verse 8, says the Lord, who is, who was, and who is to come, the Lord Almighty. I just want to point this out to you, just in passing. Look at verse 6. He has made us to be a kingdom and priests. I found it astounding. Why? And very relevant to us, because we just finished the book of Zechariah, right? Not finished, half of it anyway, until chapter 8. So we do chapter 9 to chapter 14, the second quarter of this year. The third quarter of this year, rather. But I found this astounding, very striking. He made us to be a kingdom and priests. SIBKL, I'm going to ask you, where was this concept of kingdom and priests first mooted in the Old Testament? You're right. Zechariah chapter 6. And you've heard me expound on that chapter when Zechariah took the crown and crowned not Zerubbabel, who was the governor and from the lineage of David, but crowned Joshua, the high priest, and then took the crown and placed it back into the temple. And this prophetic act is so significant because it inaugurated the priesthood of all believers. What was initiated in the Old Testament was fulfilled in the New Testament and now culminated in Revelations. Scripture is very, very consistent. Read with me, 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9, friends. Come, let's do that. Shall we do that? Come, let's all do that. Are you ready? Are you ready? 1, 2, 3. We are a chosen people. Start again. I didn't hear you. Okay, let's all read again. Are you ready? Everyone, mom, dad, children, read 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9 with me. Are you ready? 1, 2, 3. We are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people belonging to God, that you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his wonderful light. So we are all to become a kingdom of priests. Let me read Revelation chapter 1, verse 9 to 18 now. I, John, your brother and companion in the suffering and kingdom and patient endurance that are ours in Jesus, was on the island of Patmos because of the word of God and the testimony of Jesus. Verse 10. On the Lord's day, I was in the Spirit, and I heard behind me a loud voice like a trumpet, which said, write on a scroll what you see and send it to the seven churches, to Ephesus, Smyrna, Pergamum, Thyatira, Sardis, Philadelphia, and Laodicea. I turned around to see the voice that was speaking to me. And when I turned, what did John see? I saw seven golden lampstands, and among the lampstands was someone like a son of man, dressed in a robe, reaching down to his feet, and with a golden sash around his chest. His head and his hair were white like wool, as white as snow, and his eyes were like blazing fire. Now, note the description of Jesus. Note the description of Jesus. Verse 12, his feet were like bronze, glowing like a furnace, and his voice was like the sound of rushing waters. In his right hand, he held seven stars, and out of his mouth came a sharp, double-edged sword. His face was like the sun, shining in all its brilliance. And when I saw him, I fell at his feet as though dead. And then he placed his right hand on me and said, "Don't be afraid, John, don't be afraid. I am the first and the last. I am the living one. I was dead, and behold, I am alive forever and ever, and I hold the keys of death and Hades." Verse 9. "I, John, your brother and companion in the suffering and kingdom and patient endurance that are ours in Christ Jesus, was on the island of Patmos because of the word of God and the testimony of Jesus." How did John introduce himself? "I, John." He didn't say, "I, John, an apostle. I, John, I'm the beloved of Jesus." No, "I, John, your brother and companion in the suffering and patient endurance that are ours in Christ." In other words, John's saying to you, "I identify with you, friend. What I'm going to share to you is not nice. What I'm going to share to you is not what you want to hear. Never mind. I still got to tell you what's going to happen in the end days. But I, John, I am a companion to your suffering and the kingdom and the patient endurance that are ours, not only mine, not you and me, and ours in Christ Jesus." We have, got to go through much suffering and persecution in the end days. And then he says, in verse 10, "On the Lord's day, I was in the Spirit, and I heard behind me a loud voice like a trumpet." On the Lord's day. No, it's not Sunday. So what is the Lord's day? I put a picture up of Emperor Domitian, the time AD 96. Emperor Domitian was the emperor in Rome. He was touted as one of the cruelest emperor ever lived against the Christians. And every year, this guy is so egoistic, like an egomaniac. On the Lord's Day, he called it, every citizen, everyone in the entire Roman Empire will now bow down to his statue wherever you are, and you are to say, "The emperor is Lord." It is called the annual Lord's Day. But on this Lord's Day, purposefully, God, through Jesus Christ, sent his angels, unveiled to John the Apocalypse, to tell John, "John, tell the church, the emperor is not Lord. Jesus Christ is Lord." So on the Lord's day, very, very purposeful and deliberate, the unveiling of the end times was given to John. Chapter 1, verse 12 to verse 16 is very important. Hear me well now. You follow me. I'm so sorry if I go beyond time today. How to do the book of Revelation in just half an hour, I don't understand. So is it okay with you if I just go beyond time a little bit? If it's okay with you, can I see your thumbs up? Yeah, only 50% of you. Come on, show me a thumbs up, encourage me. All right. Thank you. Thank you so much. I see all of you. Verse 12. John then turned around to see the voice that was speaking to him. And that voice was loud, you see. A loud voice like a trumpet. He turned around. And when I turned, what did John see? The first thing he saw was seven golden lampstands. What are the lampstands? Revelations chapter 1, verse 20 tells us, The seven stars are the angels of the seven churches. The seven lampstands are the seven churches. So he saw the lampstands, which represent the seven churches. And among the lampstands was someone like the Son of Man. And he recognized this as Jesus. And look at the description. Look at the way that Jesus now appeared himself to John, dressed in a robe, reaching down to his feet, and with a golden sash around his chest, is a sign of a judge and a king. And his head and hair were white like wool, as white as snow, and his eyes were like blazing fire, and his feet were like bronze glowing in a furnace. In other words, we call it burnished bronze. In other words, red hot bronze. And his voice was like a sound of rushing waters. And in his right hand were held seven stars, and out of his mouth came a sharp double-edged sword. His face was like a sun shining in all its brilliance. And you know something? You know something? You know, when John turned around, he expected to see Jesus like the Jesus he knew before. How did John saw Jesus before? The last time John saw Jesus, 60 years ago, was at the Mount of Olives. When Jesus told them that he's going back to the Father, go into all the world and preach the gospel. And then it was a private affair. And there's nobody else there except all the 11 or 12 disciples. And I'm very sure, I'm speculating here, I'm just letting my imagination run wild, friends. There were probably hugs, goodbyes, you know, and see you again, you know, I'm going back, but I'll come back again. It's very encouraging. And then they watched him, and they keep watching him, and keep watching him until he disappeared and ascended up on the high and still watching. And the angels say, hey, friends, don't watch anymore. Please, because this same Jesus is going to come back again. So now go. So it was very private, very serene, very warm. But this Jesus is different. So I put a table up just to compare with us the difference between the Jesus that John knew. After all, John was called the beloved, right? The beloved of the Lord. And the Jesus that John saw. At his first coming, Jesus came back to take what was lost. Now at the second coming, Jesus comes back to take over what is his. Wow! To take back his inheritance. At the first coming, Jesus went to the cross to destroy sin, to die for you and for me, shed his blood. But now at the second coming, Jesus now comes to destroy Satan. At his first coming, Jesus went to the cross. Second coming, Jesus wears the crown, the diadema. You see, there are two crowns, the Stephanos, which is a victor's crown. So the beast, Antichrist, wears the Stephanos, but he doesn't wear the diadema. The diadema is the crown of the king. Why? Because only the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords is worthy to wear the diadema. Everybody else wears the Stephanos. At the first coming, Jesus comes as a savior. Second coming, Jesus comes as the judge and the King of Kings. And that's exactly what John saw. Eyes blazing, a sash, feet like burnished bronze, his voice like roaring waters, hair white as snow, glowing with all the glory. And what did John respond when he saw it? Verse 17 and verse 18, I fell at his feet, though dead. Why? Because this is the different Jesus. Actually, it's not right. It's the same Jesus. Jesus hasn't changed, my friend. But now he comes with a different mission. There's a difference. So when I saw him, John fell at his feet as though dead. Why? Because of the Shekinah glory of the King of Kings. You know, I don't know. I've yet to come across anybody who faints when he greets the Agong. I've yet to come across somebody who So a lady who faints when she curtsies to the Queen of England. But here John, when he saw Jesus in all his brilliance, fell down as though dead. What did Jesus do? Jesus placed his hand, right hand is the right hand of power, on John and says, "Son, John, don't be afraid. Don't be afraid, John. I am the first. I am the last. I am the living one. I was dead, and behold, I'm alive forever and ever and ever." Everybody say, "Amen, amen." "And I hold the keys of death and Hades." Very interesting. And I find this so spectacular and striking. When Jesus revealed himself to John, how did Jesus wants himself to be identified? Not as the earthly Jesus. He didn't say to John, "John, I am the Savior. I am your master." No. He said, "John, I am the first, I am the last, and I want you now to see me as such. I am the living one. I was dead, and behold, I'm alive forever and forever." In other words, Jesus wanted John to see him as the eternal king, not the earthly man, understand? It's over. Over. "And I hold the keys of death and Hades." And verse 19, I'm going to close soon, tells us the whole purpose of why Jesus asked John to write Revelations. You can say, this is the outline. "Write therefore," verse 19, "what you have seen and what is now and what will take place. The mystery of the seven stars that you saw in my right hand and of the seven golden lampstands is this. The seven stars are the angels of the seven churches, and the seven lampstands are the seven churches. And everything, John, that I'm going to show you is for the seven churches, not only in my letters. Write, therefore, what you have seen." In other words, what you see. "What is now, what happening to the seven churches, and what will take place later, the end days." So it is how we divide Revelations. What is now and what will take place. Let me close. I want to go back. I'm so astonished by this. And I want to relate it and contextualize it here, that now, as we study the book of Revelation, we must now begin to see Jesus as the king, as the judge. Because that's how Jesus would want us to view him as we go through verse by verse, chapter by chapter in the book of Revelation. "When I saw him," verse 17 and 18, "I fell at his feet, though dead. Then Jesus placed his right hand on me and said, 'Don't be afraid. Don't be afraid. Don't have any fear. What I'm going to reveal to you, don't have any fear. I'm the first and the last. I'm the living one. I was dead, and behold, I'm alive forever and forever, and I hold the keys of death and Hades." And that's exactly how Jesus himself revealed himself at his coming in Revelation chapter 19 and the last three chapters of Revelation. Jesus says, "Behold, I'm coming soon." Same thing. "I'm the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last, the beginning and the end." Now, I won't have time. You go back and read Revelation chapter 19, verse 11 to 16, when Jesus returns back the second time, and you read the description in those six verses, verse 19, verse 11 to verse 16, exactly the same description as Revelation chapter 1. In other words, and I'm going to close, when John wrote Revelation chapter 1 and saw Jesus for all his glory, Jesus was giving John a preview of what he will be like when he comes back again. Revelation chapter 1, description of Jesus is exactly the same as Revelation chapter 19, verse 11 to 16, at His second coming. So let me close. What is our response as we look forward to the study of the book of Revelations? For me, I think the key verse is found in the middle of Revelations. Your response and my response is this. Revelations 14, verse 12. This calls for patient endurance on the part of the saints. In other words, Christians who will go through the great tribulation and suffering and persecution. Believe me, it's going to increase in the coming days. Who obey God's command and remain faithful to Jesus. Revelation chapter 13, verse 10, say the same thing. If anyone is to go into captivity they will go. If anyone is to be killed with the sword they will be killed. In other words, if you have to die, we will die. Don't be afraid of death. This calls for patient endurance and faithfulness on the part of God's people. My prayer for you and for me, my friend, is this. In the coming days, as we expect greater challenges, as we expect greater opposition to Christians and to Christianity worldwide in all its various forms, what the Lord is saying to you and to me is this. Come on, let's endure. Let's persevere. Let's be resilient. Let's not give up. Let's remain faithful to the very end, my friend, to the very end. And I say this to my pastors and to my staff. Just recently, he said, my greatest fear as your pastor, as a senior pastor, is this. I told my pastors and my staff, is that you all won't make it. Is that you will give up. My greatest fear is that you will, it's okay, you leave SIBKL and go to another church. It's okay. But don't leave God. Remain faithful, my friend. Remain faithful to the very end. And I say this to you. If anything, the book of Revelation will teach us to get ready for what is going to come. But in the process, don't give up. Patiently endure and remain faithful to Jesus. Let me pray. Father, in Jesus' name, we thank you for the word, the overview of Revelations, all encapsulated in one chapter. We thank you, Lord, for putting your hand like you did upon John. Do not fear, do not fear, for I am with you. I am the Alpha, I am the Omega, the first and the last, and I hold the keys. Don't fear. So, Father, I pray that for everyone here who's going through difficult days, give us the endurance, the perseverance, oh God, not to give up, but to endure. And, Lord, to remain faithful to you to the very end. Oh, Father, we look forward to the coming weeks, Lord, when we hear more of you and understand more of the apocalypses, the unveiling of God through Jesus Christ to us. Hallelujah. Friend, come on, let's worship the Lord with this wonderful song. For of him and to him and through him are all things. Let's worship the Lord together.
Glory forever, amen. depths of the rich spoke of the wisdom and knowledge of God. How unsearchable are His judgments and
Hallelujah, Lord, hallelujah. Lord, thank you for revealing to us the mystery. Because we know, Father, Lord, we are your servants and we will understand. Open our eyes, open our spiritual minds and understanding so that in the coming weeks as we look at the book of Revelation, Lord, we will understand. And in understanding, prepare, get ourselves ready for what lies ahead of us, that we will not cave in, we will not give in, we will not give up, but rather, Father, even love you more, draw closer to you. Oh, Father, I want to pray and bless once again those people who are going through so difficult times today. Strengthen them, help them, whatever they're going through in their work, in their families, among themselves, the turmoil, the uncertainty. God, in the name of Jesus, strengthen them, Lord, strengthen them, empower them. Do not leave them nor forsake them. Hallelujah, Father. I bless you, Jesus. I bless you this day. Oh, hallelujah. And so may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make His face always to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord turn His face towards all of you and give us shalom. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. Those of you who need further prayers, please go to the online prayer line, prayer room. There will be people who will pray with you, pray for you. God bless you. See you next week when we do the overview to the seven churches. God bless you. Have a wonderful, wonderful week.
Thank you for joining us for service today. If you would like someone to pray for you, head over to the link and our pastors and leaders would love to pray and connect with you. If you would like to give, you can go to this giving link and all the giving details will be there for you. Thank you for sowing into God's kingdom this season. You are a blessing. Don't forget to like and subscribe to our YouTube channel so that you can stay connected for the latest content. Follow us on our social media platforms at SIBKL Church on Facebook and Instagram. You can also visit our website at sibkl.org.my for more info about our church. Stay updated on the latest sermons on Spotify and Apple Podcasts.
Hi everyone, would you like to get to know SIBKL a little bit more? If you've ever had such questions like, how can I join a cell group? How can I serve in a ministry? How can I be discipled? How can I be a member? How can I join one of our SIBKL events? Or any other questions, then I invite you to click on the link below and we will connect with each other via WhatsApp. One of our Connect leaders will reach out to you. We would love to connect with you, so we invite you to connect with us. God bless.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him, from above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Praise God, praise God, praise God, who saved my soul. Praise God, praise God, praise God, from whom all blessings flow.
Oh, we praise you, Lord. Come on, church, let's sing it again.
Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below.
Amen.
Praise Him above,
church. Are you ready to praise Him today? Come on, hey, come on, put your hands like this. Come on, hey.
Wanna give you what you deserve and hold nothing in reserve.
No matter
how I'm feeling, I still believe it's what you deserve.
All my praise all belongs to you.
Belongs to you.
All my praise belongs to you.
My praise,
amen,
belongs to you.
Come on, church, are you ready? Let's shout it out.
Shout it to the world, you're the greatest.
Sing it till it's heard,
you're the greatest.
It's what you deserve,
you're the greatest. Jesus, I will lift your name.
All right, oh, Jesus, come on.
Wanna give you what you deserve and hold nothing in reserve.
No matter what,
no matter how I'm feeling, I still believe it's what you deserve.
Come on, all my praise.
My praise,
oh,
belongs to you.
All my praise belongs to you.
Oh, my praise,
amen,
belongs to you.
Come on, church, are you ready?
Shout it to the world, you're the greatest. Sing it till it's heard, you're the greatest. It's what you deserve, you're the greatest. Jesus, I will lift your name. I'm high,
oh, that I sing. Oh, we bless your name.
I lift your name, I'm high.
Oh, come on, church, are you ready to lift your praise on into this place?
Everything that has grabbed, praise the Lord. He is worthy to be praised. Everybody shout unto the Lord.
Come on, church, and shout. Oh, amen.
We lift you higher, singing on the call. For you are worthy to be praised. Everybody shout unto the Lord. You're the greatest,
amen.
You're the greatest. You're the greatest. Jesus, I will lift your name. I'm high.
Oh, we bless your name. Oh, we magnify your name.
I lift your name. I'm high.
Come on, church, wherever you are, we're gonna praise His name forever, amen. Oh, one, two.
Let everything that has been, praise the Lord. We need to be praised. Everybody shout.
magnify your name, Lord. Oh, Jesus.
You are here. As we're lifting up your name, lifting up your name, you are here.
As we're giving.
As we're giving you the praise, giving you the praise. The kingdom of God is released in this atmosphere.
We're freedom.
We're freedom and breakthrough and victory are right here.
Come on, where you are.
And where you are is where I wanna be, in your presence. There's no place that I would rather be, 'cause with you, Jesus, it's heaven on earth.
Come on.
And you are here.
Season, your grace has been enough. about you, Lord, like never before.
Yes, call your presence.
Your presence is an open door. So come now, Lord, like never before.
Yes, Lord, your presence is an open door. Your presence is here with us. No matter where we are at, God, your presence is here with us. So Lord, today we fix our eyes on you. We worship you. We say, God, you are so worthy. Oh Lord, you are so worthy of all our praise and adoration, God. Jesus, we worship you today.
Sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe.